trying to make it right. Just didn't have the power, and you ignored all my tears. In the hopes they disappear. I tried to let it go,
but I can't.
You just don't wanna know. And if I had a dime for every time I tried to call your name, so tell me, I'd be wealthy. Yeah. Learned that I could cope. Well, 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 well. I discovered I could make it. Oh, in nights so long and cold, so cold, you don't know how cold. I discovered I could take it. Now I wouldn't change a thing. No, no. Not for the knowledge, not for the knowledge that I've gained. Let me say it like this. I learned that I could grow. I really did. I tried to let it show.
Into this world.
The Lord is my light and my salvation. Of whom shall I fear? The Lord is the strength of my life. And whom shall I be afraid? Lord, thou hast been our dwelling place in all generations. Before the mountains were brought forth, forever thou hast formed the earth and the world, even from everlasting to everlasting, thou art God. I will lift my eyes unto the hills, which cometh my help. My help cometh from the Lord, which made heaven and earth. He shall not suffer thy foot to be moved. He that keepeth thee will not slumber. Behold, he that keepeth Israel shall neither slumber nor sleep. The Lord is thy keeper. The Lord is thy shade upon thy right hand. The sun shall not smite thee by day, nor the moon by night. The Lord shall preserve thee from all evil. People shall preserve thy soul. The Lord shall preserve thy going out and thy coming in. From this time forth, even forevermore.
Thank you. Thank you. Show you his favor and give you his peace. May you be comforted by the reading of God's our darkest times, we can always find encouragement and strength in the Word of God. Paul gives us such encouragement in the book of 2 Corinthians chapter 14, verses 16 through 18, and I want to end with chapter 5 and verse 1. We know it very well. For which cause we faint not, but though our outward man perish, yet the inward man is renewed day by day. For our light affliction, which is but for a moment, worketh for us a far more exceeding and eternal weight of glory. While we look not at the things which are seen, but at the things which are not seen. For the things which are seen are temporal, but the things which are not seen are eternal. Chapter 5, verse 1, the final verse. For we know that if our earthly house of this tabernacle were dissolved, we have another building of God, a house not made with hands, eternal in the heavens. The word of God for God's people.
thank God for all of these preachers, pastors that we have. I really want to appreciate and thank God, like I said, for the pastor of this church, Pastor Jerry C. Amen. Our beloved Bishop, Bishop O.L. Meadows, Jurisdiction 1, Church of God in Christ, who love this family and care for this family. Even the speaker person that's going to do the eulogy, Superintendent Jim Allen, amen, on today, and all these superintendents and pastors. We appreciate every one of the preachers that is out there, pastors, preachers, amen. We appreciate you for coming today, for we see how you love this family and this great woman of God. When I said great woman of God, a great woman of God. Tributes, 2 minutes please, on the program. Superintendent Murray Johnson, as a former pastor, Pastor Joseph Hardy, as a friend, Pastor Eugene and Lady Cynthia Nixon as a cousin and friend, Wadell Pierce as a sister, children, amen. And will you come in that order, please?
You could just say glory.
Glory.
Truly, I honor the Lord today, and amen to the family. Amen. And I just thank God for being able to say words concerning Sister Beverly as a pastor. First of all, I'd like to say I wish that all the women in the nonchurch would be like her as far as a memory. Amen. And I thank God that she was a person that you could talk to. And I thank God that sometimes she would come to me and maybe with a serious question and remarks or whatever, and she knew how to do that. She did it with honor and also with respect. I thank God that she knew how to respect her pastor and yet say what she had to say. And I thank God, you know, for that. 2 minutes, really, I'm going to honor that, but you know how we preach a lot sometimes, we have a tendency to go, but I thank God, I want to be an example. I want to hold it to 2 minutes. Amen. And Ella Pruitt mentioned about her being the cook. Yes, she was an excellent cook, and she knew that I loved vegetables. And she would come, but then I got some vegetables, come by and get some vegetables, watermelon or whatever it was. She knew I loved watermelon too. And I would go by there and have a great time with the family, amen, as a pastor. And I thank God for, you know, people that love God, people that want to serve God. But we serve God through serving humanity, through serving our brothers and sisters. And I thank God for her, knowing her, that she loved the Lord. Thank God for her being a woman of God. Amen. And as a woman of God, she exemplified herself as a woman of God. And I thank God for the family, Dick and McMath. Amen. And I thank God for him. I'm going to say this, and I remember that he was getting ready to go to school, go back to school. He said, Pastor, came to me, said, Pastor, I'm getting ready to go back to school, so I might not be able to be here like that. You know, well, because I'll be in school. I said, okay. I said, one thing don't forget. I said, don't forget God. And the Lord bless him. Amen. Look where he is now.
Amen.
And to the children, I thank God for them. Amen. Bless. Amen. And she was sort of more, I guess she was a little bit more outspoken than Brianna. Amen. And I just thank God. Now, that was my side. I have to give my story. Somebody else might have a different story, but this is my story. Amen. And I thank God for her. And Brother Nye, Junior called him, the second. Amen. He had his way too. So I just thank God for them. And I just praise God how the Lord has blessed them, amen, to be where they are today. I've truly enjoyed serving as their pastor. I was supposed to have been a little temporary, but it wound up being 10 years. But there was some wonderful 10 years, praise God, that I served there. And I just want to say I love you all very much. And we're going to always, amen, we'll always be friends. And I just thank God for this opportunity to have a remark. Thank God for this woman of God that's going on to meet her maker. And if I had to give my consent, I would say, for New Bethel, well done, Sister Beverly. Amen. Amen. But it's the master that said, well done, the map of eternal life. God bless you.
Praise the Lord, everybody.
Praise the Lord.
To the host pastor of this great assembly, when I first walked in, I thought I was really sick. I've been a twin of his for a long time. When I go home to Tuscaloosa, I can be in the mall, I can be in McDonald's. Everybody say, Reverend C. And I try to land on the road, I'm Reverend C. Amen. And I also want to give thank God, amen, for Superintendent Johnson. Now, he just said that he wanted to be an example. And he was a good example, amen, for 2 minutes. Even though he went over. So I want to follow Superintendent Johnson. To all the pastors, amen, to the Reed family. They are my family. Amen. I met the McMath in 1990. And when we moved here to Jasper from Tuscaloosa, I had a dream, amen, about Brother McMath. And y'all, excuse me, I always call him Mac. Is all right, Mac? We always he called me Joe. And I had a dream, amen, that he would open up a business and he knocked at my door and asked me that I want a job. That next morning, he knocked at my door and asked me that I want a job. I said, yes, sir. And that's how I came in relationship with this family. I met Beverly. And when he opened the plant, amen, we went through a lot of things. Me and Beverly prayed a lot of days. Sometimes she come in there and things weren't going right. She said, Joe, we need to pray. Let's pray. We're still over in the office and we'll pray. Okay. Then there was sometimes she'd come in there and she had a saying, I don't know, Joe. I said, no, we just got to believe God. She said, I don't know, Joe. And we had plenty of time, man, and we laughed a lot. And so one day after we had been here a few times, and lived here 5 years, we moved to Birmingham. We would come down and see the family. And before we leave, we would have prayer. And while we were praying, the Lord showed me that he was gonna bless them with a new home. Okay. When we got through praying, Beverly said, I don't know, Joe. Things were dark in their life. They were going through some things. And so when we got through praying, Max showed me the blueprint. And Beverly said, I don't know, Joe. And then when the Lord blessed them with the home, and I walked in, I said, what do you think about it now, Beverly? She said, it had to be God. And then another thing about Beverly, some of the preachers have already stated it, but when New Beverly would have a program, and we would have a good time, and Mac be on the organ and she be the MC. And after a while, amen, she get to talking about the Lord and expound on what others said about it. And she started getting happy. And the worst thing that happened was Mac hit a call. Do I have some good news? hit that card, she started walking. And everybody knows about Beverly, she loved them high heels. And when she get started and Matt get another note, another card, that's all it takes. And she have a shout that nobody else can shout. You couldn't get it there if you tried. And how she did it with them high heels on, I couldn't tell you. I seen you, Mac, when he gets started on that keyboard and on that organ, it's church time. And I seen old mother one time, mother was 80-something years old, and she came in with a can. But when Mac got to wear that organ, after she put her hands on her hip, she started stepping. And I had to fan him, and I said, man, you better quit. Then that go better. But what's so good about after the program? Better than going in the kitchen. I'm going to tell you, she knew how to prepare a meal. We would be there for that macaroni and cheese, that potato salad, potato pie, and no collard greens. And one thing she going to do is make sure the preacher got used first. And she said, Joe, have you been serving? I said, no, man, today, I got you. And she lived a beautiful life. And I'll come behind Pastor Johnson, she respect leadership. Amen. But that's a favorite song that Beverly loved. She preached it at the church. She preached it here before the nation ministry. She preached it. She said, the Lord is my shepherd. I should not want this. He maketh me to lie down in green grass. He leadeth me beside the still waters. He restoreth my soul. He leadeth me in the path of righteousness for his name's sake. Yea, do I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for thou art with me. Thy rod and thy staff, they comfort me. Thou preparest a table before me in the presence of my enemies. Thou anointest my head with oil, my cup runneth over. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life. I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. Somebody give God praise.
Amen. This particular year, it was 1973, it was August, and I would spend summers in New York with my brother Percy. And so we were in New York, And my cousin Alice and our cousin Audrey came over to Percy's house. At the time, I didn't realize our family connection. So here comes cousin Alice with her nieces, which happens to be Beverly and Benedict, which were already my cousins. So now we double cousins. And I was really happy about that. And so Beverly and I were, and we were on the bed and we were just listening and talking. I said, Beverly, when I get home, I know this is not the right way to say it. I said, but I'm gonna get the Holy Ghost. I made up my mind, Beverly, when I get home, I'm gonna get the Holy Ghost. She said, sin I want the Holy Ghost too. So came September. Mother with the talk was running revival at New Bethel. Had no idea revival was gonna be right after our confession. And so from Wednesday till about Friday, four little girls on the altar, Beverly, me, Christy Henry, and Felicia McMath. And they set out four chairs. We can tear it from Wednesday to Friday. And listen, Friday was not going to leave without me getting the Holy Ghost. We had made up our minds, this revival cannot close. We need the Holy Ghost. So they set those chairs out, and it wasn't 1 minute, I don't think, when chairs went one way and the girls went another way. Altar tore up. We were running, jumping, speaking in tongues. And if you ever lost Beverly in church, she was underneath the bench, I'm telling y'all. We was always dragging. I said, why don't you just shout up right? Why you gotta be under the benches? Beverly was always under the benches. And that changed us forever. Along came my sister Frankie, got the Holy Ghost. Brenda received the Holy Ghost. Benedict received the Holy Ghost. Lisa Dickerson, we became just sanctified. We were known as the sanctified girls from Jasper. If you were in the convention, you knew the sanctified girls from Jasper because we met Jesus. We got it the old-fashioned way. We called on Jesus, y'all. We fell in the floor. We rolled. We stayed at the altar as much as we wanted to stay because we wanted that Holy Ghost. And so, Beverly became our missionary. Beverly, we called it teaching back in the day, but Beverly could preach. I don't care what you want to say. Beverly was preaching. Beverly could teach and preach with them stilettos on. She could go backwards as good as she could go forward in them shoes. You ain't never seen nothing like that. And she was a powerhouse. Simply a powerhouse. Bev was up preaching, everybody was trying to get to church that Sunday. If we knew it was Bev, we were coming. But she was so dynamic. And so, I'm going to give this over to my husband, but as I close, I can't think about, the Proverbs 31. If you ever wanted to see somebody who represented Proverbs 31, it was Bev. Now, this is actually, this March is called Women's History Month. And what an appropriate time to celebrate such a successful woman of God. Beverly worked side by side with her husband in several businesses. Beverly was a nurse, an entrepreneur, a leader in her community. While she was being a wife and a mother, she was a bad girl. She was simply a bad girl. And I'm so proud of her. Absolutely so proud of her. Proverbs 31 and 10 says, who can find a virtuous woman? For her price is far above rubies. Barry, I know she's priceless to you. She's priceless to all of us. So as I close, I want to say, Billy, I love you. You're my sister forever. You're my friend forever. For every conversation, for everything she taught me. She told me this, like I said, and I'm getting this to my husband for real. We were going to high school, we just got the Holy Ghost, and I was so young, I was still wearing tennis shoes and socks and dresses, but couldn't wear pants. And Beverly said, when you get to this high school, because I know she was a fashion queen, she could play. Since you get to this high school, you better take them doggone tennis shoes off. Don't you dare put them tennis shoes on. So my entire high school years, I had to wear holes and stockings. A young girl. Because Beverly told me so. So Beverly, I miss all the things you've taught me. I always miss your presence, your laughter. Nobody could laugh like Bev. Nobody can tell a joke like that. That's a Pierce thing, that joke stuff. Nobody can love me like Beverly. I love all of you. I love Beverly. Amen.
I say ditto to all that. said, honor to the pulpit, pastor of this church, saints and friends, and to the family, the McMath and the Pierce family. We grieve with you. We're so hurt. But there's a lot of things I could say about Beverly. I talked to my brother Byron. He told me I can't tell some stories. He told me, no, you can't tell that story. So I won't tell that story. I met Byron some 40 years ago or so, and Byron may not remember this. I like telling him stuff that he don't remember. Byron was gonna beat me up, you know. And I went through a yard. I want you to remember. I went through your yard, the used trab yard as a cut through. And so I went through, and I think they had a dog. It might have been a Doberman, a black dog. Come on, memory, come on back, memory. And as I went through the yard, Byron said, hey, you going through my yard. And so I did a little smart remark coming from Chicago. He said, I bet not catch you going through my yard again. I went on through the yard. And lo and behold, we became friends. And then we became best friends. And then we married cousins. We were in each other's weddings. We've come a long way. Beverly meant so much to us, but since my wife has talked about Beverly, I would like to talk about Byron. We're here to celebrate Beverly's legacy, but I'm here to honor my best friend. Byron, you was a doctor to Beverly. You made sure that whatever the doctor said, it was the right diagnosis. You was a nurse to Beverly. You made sure that she took her medicine even when she didn't want to take it. You was an orderly. You kept things in order. You kept your business in order. You kept that house in order. You kept Beverly in order. You bathed her. You clothed her. And then, the greatest of all, you was her husband. You was the epitome of the marital vows. For better or worse. Richer or poorer. And here it is, in sickness and in health. You could have left, but you didn't. It wasn't a contract, but you had a covenant marriage, and you could not leave. It wasn't a covenant, it was love that kept you there. And not only that, Byron, I would like to say to you, I give you a standing ovation. I give you a standing ovation. In this land of some more, we will have some more heartaches. We will have some more bills. We will have some more breakups. We will have some more cancer. We will have some more diabetes. But take heart, my brother, because Beverly has gone to another land. And that is a land of no more. Revelation, the 21st chapter, lets us know he shall wipe away the tears. There should be no more. No more death. I won't go to the land of no more.
I want to give honor to the Lord for being here. Man, when I look around and I see all of this love, it's amazing. Y'all know me, I'm in. I'm in. This is it, y'all. Stay over there. All right? to let you know, if you knew my sister, she wouldn't want y'all sitting around here crying. She'd be wanting you all to praise the Lord and celebrate her life. Now for me, I questioned myself. I said, what is celebrating life? I asked that question to myself. I'm sitting in my closet in California, and I'm praying, I'm crying, I'm weeping. Bell spoke to me. She said, I remember. What do you mean? I remember. All of y'all encountered my sister. Say to yourself, I remember. Remember that good time? Remember that bad time? But you remember. That's how you celebrate her life. I remember. Say it one more time.
I remember.
What?
I remember.
I remember we were had a garden. And Papa, since Granddad had planted fruit for all. Bell loves strawberries. Did she not? She loves some strawberries. So she told me and Shane, you get on one end of the house, and you get on the other end of the house and keep watching for Papa. We wasn't supposed to be in that garden. Okay? So Bell been there picking strawberries. And I said, here come Papa. She comes running out of that and she tripped. And she cut herself on her arm. She cut herself on her arm. Had to have a little stick. But I remember. I remember when Sid was saying she was shouting. Man, girl could cut a rug. Cut a rug, right? I can't shout. You know, but she could. I remember that cheese and macaroni. Make you want to slap somebody, right? Come on now. This is celebrating her life. Yeah. And when you leave here today, I want you to remember.
Yeah.
You say to yourself, I remember. Yeah. I remember that time when me and Beth did this. I remember that time when she said this to me. I remember. Now, listen, y'all. You heard Brother Gene talk about Bible. Man, this is one strong cat.
Amen.
Y'all, understand me. He's not only my brother-in-law, but he was my big brother as I grew up. He took me everywhere. He took me. Hey, you see Barry? Where's he at? He's right there. Okay? Y'all understand. This thing, we grew up together. This was God's working. Right? And I just want to say, when y'all live here today, y'all remember. You say to yourself, I remember.
She welcomed her home to most of our friends who really became our sisters. It only made sense that they would come home with us because she had us right back at church at YPWW. So, but it was really like her hospitality that made them feel important and welcome. She was so supportive. My girl, anybody knows her, Byron was her baby. So I often remember her picking him up from school. And like any normal parent, they just have like a little snack or something. Like say you get something from home. He had Lee's chicken, he had a whole meal. And anybody else that picked him up knew to have him a whole meal. Like my grandma picked him up, least she can go be in a car. KFC can go be in a car. She was supportive of me and all of my sports. I could hear her being at my basketball game saying, shoot the ball, Brianna, put your hands up, like she's always doing. So just being that supportive mom. She taught me love, patience, and endurance. I'm still working on that patience part, but she knew it. As we got older, she really became our friend. One who we could vent to with absolutely no filters. We could say whatever and she would just laugh. We had a running joke saying, you're just like your daddy. But while I may look like him, I think I really do act more like her. You taught me how to pray and you led by example. I remember just about every time you preached, you made sure that Bliss and I were either singing or dancing before you got up. I feel like you did that because you knew when we got home we was gonna critique you. Whether it was like, mommy was a little long-winded today. Or whether it was the way she just said hallelujah and shook her hair. We knew which scripture she was gonna talk about. The woman with the issue of blood, that was her favorite message to preach. And she knew it, so we were gonna always talk to her about it. Many days and holidays, we watched and we always helped prep whenever she cooked. And then the first time, she somewhat relinquished control, but she wasn't gonna let it go completely. She was astonished to see that we actually had paid attention and that the food was up to par. I'm forever on chicken and dressing. Bliss is on the mac and cheese. She never let us touch the greens or the pies, though. I can hear her saying, move, or just get out the way, because we played. She would always say, y'all playing too much, just get it done. So unknowingly to us at the time, you were setting us up for when you wouldn't be here, to make sure we could cook and take care of our families the way you did yours. You taught me how to be a wife and a mother. You were the best Nana, and I often joke that you and Evan are just alike with your attitudes. I know you loved us and we loved you. She was the most loving, humble, compassionate, understanding, family-oriented woman, and one of the most beautiful souls one could ever meet. So I want to say to you, job well done, Mom. We have it from here.
Been in law school, and we had developed a routine. We eat Brianna, Byron, and my mom would cook. She cooked every Sunday. We didn't go out to eat, but she cooked full meals every Sunday. And me and my husband, we were joking about it because in most families, whatever your parents cook, that's what you eat. If you don't want it, you don't eat that. But that wasn't the case in our home. If she cooked meatloaf, Brianna didn't eat meatloaf, she cooked the roast, so we have roast and meatloaf on Wednesday. She made sure that she cooked things that we liked. But, you know, my mom's the cool one, dad's the strict one. So, you know, when he came home and graduated, you know, from law school, we was like, what is this? You know, what is this? Because we had our routine, because my mom, she would, you know, fix our plates and fix what we would like. My dad came, he fixed everything, was like, y'all need this, you know? We're like, oh God, Mom, when are you going back to school? He was like, that's over, he got home for good, and he was like, God. But that was just, you know, the relationship that we had in our household. And like my sister said, everywhere my mom went, she had us going with her. She either had us singing or dancing. So the only little song that I could probably think about that my mom probably be a testament of our life is, I gotta get myself together, cause I got some place to go, and I'm praying when I get there, I see everyone I know, I wanna go.
of Deacon McMath and demanding that anyone may speak of the five people, please. But man, but this is time, and I know what he said. So we're going to go ahead on in the program on today. God bless you on today. I like to say that Deacon McMath, the last time when I talked to you, I said, you are a what? A good man. This is a strong man. And I appreciate him. The last message that Missionary McMath spoke on at New Bethel was Isaiah 61:3. God will give you beauty for ashes. Joy for your mourning. As she spoke on the anointed power of God. Amen. God bless you. Resolutions. Amen. First Lady. Amen. Evangelist Betty Crew is coming for one that we have. Anybody else? Amen.
Missionary Beverly McMath. I have fought a good fight. I have finished my course. I have kept the faith. Henceforth there is laid up for me a crown of righteousness, which the Lord, the righteous judge, shall give me at that day. And not to me only, but unto all of them also that love his appearing. 2 Timothy 4:7-8. Whereas God has brought to a close the life of Missionary Beverly McMath, the pastor and members of the New Bethel Church of God in Christ, Jasper, Alabama, feel that it is befitting to express our sympathy to the family during this time of bereavement. We commend you to him who knoweth best and will always do right. You have our sincere prayers. Whereas Missionary Beverly McMath was a young and vibrant woman, a wife, mother, grandmother, and friend, Missionary McMath was saved, sanctified, and filled with the precious gift of the Holy Ghost. She was a gifted and anointed woman of God who stood bold and well-versed in the Word of God. She taught under the anointing and caused many lives to be touched, healed, and delivered. The power of God would come upon her, and she would dance before her God, giving him praise and thanks. She was an industrious woman who loved to cook and serve God's people. Many great leaders of the church and community sat and ate from her table. She was a true servant of God. Her presence and spirit certainly left a sweet, sustaining memory in our hearts. Be it resolved that we know your loss is deep and your sorrow is great, but we want you to know that we share in your sorrow. But more importantly, we recognize that this loss is heaven's gain. We bow in humble submission to him who never makes a mistake and remind the family to be encouraged by remembering this poem. Remember me. Remember me with smiles, not tears, for all the joy through the years. Recall the closeness that was ours, a love as sweet as fragrant flowers. Don't dwell on thoughts that cause you pain. We'll see each other once again. I am at peace. Try to believe it was my time. I had to leave. But what a view I have from here. I see your face. I feel you nearby. I follow you throughout the day. You're not alone along the way. And when God calls you, you will be right by my side, right here with me. Till then, I'll wait by heaven's door. We'll be united evermore. Be it further resolved that a copy of this resolution given to the family and a copy placed in New Bethel Church of God in Christ archives, humbly submitted on this 27th day of March, 2024, New Bethel Church of God in Christ, Jasper, Alabama, Elder Avery Pruitt, Pastor. God bless you.
Thank you. Preachers know how to because I know that God is the only one that can give us what the people and the family actually need. I trust what He has entrusted into my hand. My intentions are not to be long, because it's not going to take me long to do. But I need to, there's a couple of things that I need to say regarding Beverly. And regarding Byron, we called him Baron. I want to speak in regards to Baron, but let me digress for just a moment. Certainly it's already been said, thank the pastor of this church. He has given me permission to stand in this space, because this is his house. Respect you, sir, but you can only be thanking you to all of the clergymen. But most of us in this room, let me just say, everybody that go way back with Byron and Beverly, say amen.
Amen.
We have a long history, and time will not afford me to go down memory lane, but there are a couple of important things. As a youngster, Byron and I were scheduled to go to a certain city. But like Jesus, he had need of going through Samaria. We had need of going to Jasper, Alabama, to Deacon Percy and Missionary Mary Hill's house. I must say that was the best stop I ever made in my life, because Byron took me over to the person in Mother Mary Hill's house, and there's a little girl about 4'6" and a half now. Man, Frankie was there, and so the rest is history. We became husband and wife. Byron was in my wedding. My brother-in-law Eugene was in my wedding. We actually swapped. We were in each other's wedding. I actually played in a band, because I think it was Eugene that won the band for his wedding. I think Byron did too. So we have a long history of custom building stair-step relationships where God has just knitted our lives together. Even though we lived in separate cities, we never broke the bond of our relationship. I remember when all the children were born. To digress to Beverly, I thank God for Beverly resting in her grave, because Beverly was responsible for my wife learning how to make peach cobbler and sweet potato pie. Byron, what you did not know, that every time I wanted a dish made in my house, I would bring up your wife's name. My wife, you know how women are, they don't want no other woman in their house. You start bragging on another woman and her cooking, it's gonna be some stuff going on. So every time I wanted something, and I wanted it cooked, I just mentioned Beverly's name. I called Beverly and asked her, would she make me some macaroni and cheese? Don't worry about that, I got that. So I want to say that I thank God for your wife and the legacy that she left in my house. Everybody that ate at that table, say amen. Everybody got a good meal and a doggy bag. No, it wasn't no doggy bag, it was a trash bag. We got some good eating there. This is helping me to settle myself so I can do my assignment, but I thank God for these two fine individuals. And after fleecing the Lord and asking him what it should be that I should say today, the scripture that he took me to was found in the book of St. John. St. John chapter number 11, verse number 20, and verse number 21. I'll be reading this text from the New Living Translation. today. The word of the Lord says, when Martha got word that Jesus was coming, she went to meet him, but Mary stayed in the house. Martha said to Jesus, Lord, if only you had been here, my brother would not have died. If only you had been here, my brother would not have died. I want you to just look at somebody and say these two words with me. Say, if only. That's what I want to talk about today. If only. How many of you in here have said those two words? We hear it a lot from our wives. If only you just listened. Traveling to a place you've never been before. If only you would just pay attention. As parents, we say it to our children, if only you would understand that I know more than you know. In school, the teacher tells the student, if only you pay attention and write down the information for the test, you do better. We live our lives many times with those two words, if only. When we lose a loved one, we all respond to that loss in different ways. Some people respond to their loss with regret as they focus on the past. Their grief is defined by their guilt about what was, but should not have been, or their guilt about what should have been, but was not. The words they often think and say with respect to their deceased loved ones are, if only. Would you say, if only?
If only.
If only I had visited more. If only I had told her I love her more often. If only I had done more for her. If only. If only you and I could change the past. If only we could alter the circumstances that resulted in our instant loss and constant pain. Brothers and sisters, I want to tell you today, we cannot change yesterday. Would you help me say that? We cannot change yesterday. Say these words, we can only live today. Talk to the preacher. Come on, talk to him now. Let's say that again.
We cannot change
yesterday. We can only live today. We live today despite our loss. We have to begin to replace the regretful words, if only, with the grateful word, nevertheless. Don't get you all here what I said. I said we have to replace the regretful words, if only, with the word, nevertheless. Oh, I feel my hip coming now. I wish you would just say that one more time. Nevertheless. Thank you, Lord God. Let's define the word, nevertheless. In the Old Testament, the original Hebrew word means strangely enough. A ceasing, an end, a finality. In the New Testament, Luke writes the word nevertheless is used after something negative and serves to mark a transition to something new. Oh, I think I need to say that again. I said the word nevertheless is used after something negative, and it serves to mark a transition to something new. Yes, I'm hearing today, but are y'all going to help the preacher this morning? I don't understand why it has to happen right now, but
feel pain in my heart, but
would
you just shout,
nevertheless?
I'm not going to take long today. Nowhere in the Bible does it speak in the language of if only. In a positive way, you don't find anything positive when you hear the words if only. But however frequently the Bible uses the language of nevertheless, we cannot change the painful past or bring back our loved ones. Nevertheless, we can live with gratitude for the love we had and for the life we shared. Even though that love and life ended too soon. How we will live with the grief that has rocked our world. Will we get stuck in yesterday with the words, if only? Or will we move ahead toward tomorrow with the word? Several years ago, I find this in my preparation, there was the Challenger space shuttle exploded, claiming the lives of seven crew members. The day after that tragedy, a TV crew was interviewing residents of Concord, New Hampshire, home of a teacher and crew member named Krista McAfee. One old timer was asked how the tragedy would affect the residents of Concord. He answered by saying this, "We will grieve our loss, but life will go on." The statement needs to describe us who have loved and lost. Do we grieve our loss?
Yes.
Come on, do we grieve our loss?
Yes.
All of us in this room, and we are not being insensitive by any means, but every one of us in this room at some point in time lost someone we love here. And God knows I love me some Beverly and Byron McMath, because they are close friends of mine. But we have to also understand that even in that loss, we have to find ourselves saying, oh, come on, help the preacher this. We have to say nevertheless, because we understood that God is wise in his providence. And even though we don't understand why he does what he does, he is still God, and he still knows how to help us say, oh, so we're getting in the clothes here now.
Go ahead, man.
Finally, we have the story that in Matthew chapter number 26. It tells us how the power of nevertheless was able to change an entire world. Jesus Christ was God wrapped in humanity. He knew what awaited him in the remaining hours of his life on this earth. And his human nature did not want to consent to what he had to face. Would you travel with me in the Garden of Gethsemane? Jesus, knowing that he was brought down to earth to give his life for mankind. But I thank God for the if only of Jesus. Because Jesus, at his moment of departure, he was in the garden grieving with the fact and struggling with the fact that he had to give his life. And he said these words, "Father, if it be thy will, let this bitter cup depart from me." But I thank one word in that text, that one word is, he said, "Nevertheless, not my will, but thy will be done." I just came to tell you, Byron. I just came to tell you, Bliss and Brianna and BJ, that even though we are grieving today, and we have had to say, if only, I even said to myself, when you send me the text, Lord, we are believing you to spare our life one more time. We said, God, we know you did it before, and we believe you're going to do it again. But when I got the next message, the message said that she had gone on to be with the Lord. I grieved and I cried, but I remember what Jesus did in the garden. boldness. I thank God for the time that I had to say his holy. I praise God for nevertheless. Oh,
tell your neighbor, never a lie.
Never a lie.
Deacon, holy soul. Many thanks to Pastor Pruitt and the New Bethel Church family for all of the love and support shown to the McMath.